Hello, how are you students? I'm glad to have a day with you where we are going on with our topic where we are looking at our chapter 7 and asking a question, why did the event in the Gulf matter between 1970 and 2000? So our subtopic today, we are asking ourselves what were the causes and the consequences of the Iran-Iraq war between 1980 and 1988. In our last topic, we looked at how the power was exchanged in Iraq and Iran. And now we have new leaders. We have Saddam Hussein and we have the Ayatollah on the Iran side. Now these two presidents or rulers of these two countries, how are they going to cope together? Are they going to rhyme? Are they going to fight? That's why we have the war occurring between 1980 to 1988. That's almost 8 years of war. So our topic is what were the causes and the consequences. So I'm going to start with the causes of the war, of the Iran-Iraq war of 1980-1988. Let's start with the background. So we find that Iraq and the air invasion of Western Iran in September 1980 marked the beginning of the 8-year war between the two countries. And this one destabilized the region, and also it had so many devastating to the participants, that is both Iraq and Iran. So we have few modern conflicts have been so long, bloody and pointless between the two countries, whereby you find the two countries, they had disagreement, whereby they were not able to agree on several issues. And this caused a mixture of long-standing disputes and more immediate considerations, whereby you find they have, when you have a long-term dispute, sometimes you keep it to yourself, waiting for a day when you'll be able to burst out. So some would claim that Saddam Hussein was the undoubted aggressor, or he's the one who caused the war in Iraq and Iran. Yet, it's also possible to argue that by the invading Iran, he was launching a preemptive strike whereby he wanted to destroy Cohen before Cohen destroyed him. You know, if you know you have an enemy, sometimes you may attack your enemy before your enemy attacks you. So they have some regions that they were not able to agree on, and those are the ones we are going to start looking at. So we are going to start with the territorial dispute between Iran and Iraq. And you find that when we were looking at Iran and Iraq, we said Iran is a country between two rivers, that is River Tigris and River Euphrates. You find this one emerging as one of the problems, whereby they are arguing because of the waters. You find there are some areas that were shared by the Arabs and the Persians, because you know Iran, majority are Persians, and the Iraq were the Arabs. So since Iran and Iraq, they share the border of more than 1,400 kilometers, it's hardly surprising that much of the friction between the two should be based on the territorial issues. And there were two areas in particular whereby the dispute originated. One of them, we call it the Shatara Waterway, that is the Tigris and Euphrates. And then the other one is the Iranian province, which we call Gumzetan. So these two regions, they are going to cause some conflict. So let us start by looking at the Shatan Arab Waterway. How did it cause the conflict? And I had already said that the Shatan Arab is formed by the confluence of the River Tigris and River Euphrates. So it connects Iraq city of Basra and Iranian city of Abadan and Khorasan to the Persian Gulf. So it means that these waters, they are shared by the two countries, and we find their cities are touching to those rivers. So the water was more important to both Iran and Iraq for their oil export, and especially important to Iraq because it was the only outlet to the sea. This is the only way they could get to the sea. Therefore, it looked more important to Iran even more than Iran. So the argument agreement over then affiliation rights and then to be precise, the location of Iran border along the southern 105 kilometers stretch of the river was made between the two countries favorable to Iran, and the boundary was to be marked by the low water mark on the eastern bank of the river. So they had already sat down and looked at that issue and tried to solve it. But is it going to remain like that until forever, or somebody else will come and change that agreement? So this remained the case until 1969, when Shah of Iran rejected the 1937 treaty and refused to pay any further shipping tolls to the Iraqs. So what does that mean? At one point they sat down, they agreed that since this conference of the River Tigris and Euphrates is important to Iraq, let us allow Iraq to be the one who are charging the tolls. When we talk about all these import duties, when we want to use the waters. But you find in 1969, Shah rejected that treaty and called it null and void, and therefore he could not continue paying any more toll to the Iraqs. So therefore, this one obvious to bring some conflict between the two. The other area that I've mentioned is the Khuzestan, and we need to know how was this also an important cause of the conflict. So we are told that the southwestern Iranian province of Khuzestan was oil rich with a predominantly non-Persian population. So meaning those people who are living in Khuzestan, most of them, they were not what? They were not Persian. And remember, we are counting Khuzestan as the part of Iran. So most of the non-Persians were Arab, on the contrary, who had cultural connection with the Iran neighbors to the west. So here we have people you are ruling. These people, most of them, they are not part of their language. They are part of the other neighboring language. And therefore, you find Saddam Hussein started claiming historical rights to control that province, and he started encouraging the Arabs who are living in this region to revolt against the Shah rule. So the retaliation in Iran began encouraging the Kurds in the north of Iraq. Remember, Iraq also, there are people who are not Arabs, they are Persians, and they will call them the Kurds. So the Iran started encouraging them also to take up arms against Saddam Hussein and provided them with the training as well as military equipment. So that means you are attacking me on one of my areas, and I also attack you on your one of your areas. So this was another conflicting region, and therefore they called for a conference, and that conference we call it a Arigia Agreement, whereby they sat the two parties and agreed on how they're going to end the revolt. So Saddam was astute enough to realize that the full-scale war with Iran during the early 1970s would lead to Iraq defeat, as Iran had possessed more of the powerful army in the world, and we are told it was the fifth in the world to have the strongest army. So having known this, Saddam knew that if I wage war against Saddam, against Shah, it will be automatically that I'm going to be defeated. So having ended up on the losing side in number of skirmishes and minor battles, he decided to make a tactical retreat by signing the Arigia's Agreement of 1975. So he called for a meeting, and they signed that meeting. And they signed an agreement. So after signing the agreement, we are told that it meant that now the war between the two countries looked somehow as if it has ended. So in return for Iran ending the support for the Kurdish separatists within Iran and Iraq, and therefore Iraq dropped the claim to the Khuzestan and considered that the border between Iran and Iraq along the Shatarab should follow the deep water line. That was according to the Algiers Agreement. Now, although the Algiers Agreement normalized relationship between the two, that is Iran and Iraq, it was regarded as a setback by Saddam Hussein, and he was determined to regain the lost land at the earliest opportunity. So that means they have agreed. But this one, to Saddam, it was like someone who had been defeated, and therefore he has to look for ways of regaining that lost glory. So shortly before invading Iran in September 1980, Saddam announced that the Arujia Agreement was null and void. In our next clip, we are going to look at the domination of the Gulf by the Iran and Iran, and how they are going to do it. Welcome to our next clip. Let's meet there.